According to the physics of the 19th century, an object of non-zero temperature would be emitting an infinite amount of energy. This can't be right. Well, it isn't, but the very solution of this problem started a new era in the world of physics. And it has a lot to do with what light really is, a wave or a particle. The historical debate of what light really is has troubled people for centuries. Newton believed that light is made up of small particles called corpuscles, and Christian Huygens, who believed light is a wave, without much experimental observations. But around 1800s, Thomas Young conducted his famous double slit experiment and showed that light rays passing through the double slit shows interference pattern, much like as expected from waves to do. Then on, the idea of light as a wave came to be accepted. Later, Maxwell demonstrated that the speed at which electromagnetic waves propagate is exactly the speed of light, concluding that light itself is an electromagnetic wave, a disturbance in the electromagnetic field. But then, at the beginning of the 20th century, some series of events occurred which radically changed our understanding about light and arguably posed more questions about light than answered it. Hello everyone, today we'll be talking about the ultraviolet catastrophe. During the 1900s, Max Planck was working on the problem of the black body spectrum. A black body is an ideal object that does not reflect any of the light incident upon it. So the light that we can see of a black body is only by the virtue of its temperature. That makes the black body spectrum the radiation emitted by an object only by the virtue of its temperature. Since moving charges create electromagnetic waves, we expect objects to radiate energy depending upon their temperature, since temperature determines the motion of particles in an object. The different wavelengths of light have different energies. Shorter wavelengths have higher energy and longer wavelengths have lower energy. There is an entire spectrum of electromagnetic radiation. The light that we can see is only a tiny part of the vast electromagnetic spectrum. In the visible range, red light has the longest wavelength, so it has the least amount of energy. And as the wavelength of light gets longer, we reach the infrared region of the spectrum, then the microwaves, and then the radio waves, with kilometers across wavelength and the least amount of energy. On the other side of the spectrum, we have the ultraviolet rays, the X-rays, and the gamma rays, with the maximum energy and the shortest wavelength. Now the problem was that the classical wave theory of light predicts that at a given temperature, a black body will radiate more and more energy in the higher frequency waves of light, especially after the visible range in the UV spectrum. The intensity of light radiated increases very rapidly in contrast with experimental observations in the high frequency waves of light and eventually reaches infinity. Intensity of light can be thought of as the brightness of light or the amount of light. So what I was trying to say was that, according to the classical physics description of the 19th century, an object would be emitting more and more light in the higher frequency, lower wavelengths of light. An object actually emits light in all sorts of wavelengths. We ourselves radiate a lot of infrared light. But what classical physics was trying to say was that if we try to understand how much light an object emits in particular frequencies or wavelengths of light, we would find that as the wavelength of light radiated tends to zero, the intensity of light at that wavelength tends to infinity. So the total amount of energy radiated also tends to infinity. This surely can't be the case. What this meant was that the object would be emitting an infinite amount of energy. This can't be possible. This shouldn't be possible. What we expect is, for a given temperature, the intensity of light radiated should increase with frequency, should reach its maximum for a certain frequency, and then should go down. This is what experiments also tell us. We consider Sun a black body, and its black body spectrum does the same thing. But the classical physics theory was predicting that the intensity of light will keep on going on and on. This prediction of the classical physics of the intensity of light increasing very rapidly after the visible spectrum and eventually going to infinity was called the ultraviolet catastrophe. And what Planck was trying to do was to come up with a mathematical model that explains the real black body spectrum. To understand the idea he came up with, we need to understand the problem in a bit more detail. Since the energy states available in the classical electromagnetic wave is continuous, there is no restriction to the process of radiating energy. And from the equipartition theorem, each allowed wave coming out of an object in equilibrium has the same amount of energy. Since there is no restriction to the amount of energy that can be radiated, and since there are an infinite number of waves available, the energy radiated comes out to be infinite. Now, the idea Planck came up with allows us to, loosely speaking, finite the number of waves taken into consideration. Planck's proposal was that the energy radiated in the blackbody spectrum is quantized. So you can't just emit any arbitrary amount of energy. It must be an integer multiple of the smallest amount of energy possible. That means all of the energy emissions that were smaller than this base quantity just cannot be emitted. The smallest amount of energy that can be emitted equals to the frequency of light times a constant, the Planck's constant. So how does this idea make an infinite sum finite? Well, as we know that the problem was coming from the higher frequency regions of the electromagnetic spectrum, let's focus on those. Now, since the amount of smallest energy that can be radiated depends upon the frequency of the light, it's proportional to the frequency of light, even a single quantum of the higher frequency light have energies that is so large that the molecular interaction can't emit any of that radiation. That means the molecular interaction need to have the energy more than the smallest amount of energy that can be radiated to even emit that frequency of light. And since many of the molecular interactions just do not meet this condition, they will not emit any of this high frequency energetic light if they do not meet the desired temperature. Well, I thought an example would be really helpful here. Okay, so consider for a particular frequency, the smallest amount of energy that can be radiated equals 1. In some units, I'm not going to bother about. Now, since the smallest amount of energy that can be radiated is 1, in order for the object to emit this frequency of light, the molecular interactions in that object need to have at least this much amount of energy. If it can't have that, no energy will be released. And let's say if the molecular interaction in that object has about 1.5 units of that energy, then in that case only 1 unit of that energy would be released in that frequency of light, not the complete 1.5. This is what quantization did for us. Since there always be a frequency for which the required amount of energy exceeds the energy available in the interaction, no light would be released in that frequency or frequencies higher than this. Whereas earlier, every single energy states were allowed. Now, since the frequency of light, of the higher wavelength light is smaller, the smallest amount of energy available in the higher wavelength light is also smaller. So it can be thought of as approximately continuous. So this is why the classical theory worked pretty much fine for higher wavelengths of light, but for lower wavelength light, it was a catastrophe. So what this meant was that the molecular interactions and vibrations must have energy larger than this threshold to emit the light of this large frequency. Whereas in the previous model, the energy in the electromagnetic waves were continuous, so even slight interactions and vibrations were able to emit gamma or UV radiation. So this is how the proposal by Planck solved the ultraviolet catastrophe and would be marked as the downfall of classical physics and would be the beginning of a new way of thinking about the universe. But what did this quantization of energy really mean? Max Planck did not understand what this really meant. The big idea came from the mind of Albert Einstein. And you might have observed, I haven't used the word photon in this video, like the particles that we think light is made up of. And I haven't used this word because, well, photons weren't a thing when this all of the things happened. It was Einstein a couple of years after this who came up with the idea of the quanta of light, photons. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in my next video when we'll talk about Einstein's contribution in the photoelectric effect and in developing quantum physics in our next video. Bye.